Then God, thank you. Lord, you are amazing. Lord, you're mighty. And God, you are worth every single praise that we can ever give. And God, you are God even when we don't treat you like you are. You are God even when we don't acknowledge you as God. You're God even when we don't even act like we don't have an answer to you. But Father God, thank you right now. Lord, you've been so good to us, Lord, that dear God, 10,000 thank yous would not be enough. Lord, we thank you for all that you've done in this place so far. Pray for each heart in this place right now, dear God. I pray you prepare your heart, their hearts, dear God, for your word. Dear God, use this vessel so that your people are blessed. Lord, if there be anything, anybody, anyone, any attitude that will seek to rob this worship experience, dear God, deal with it as you must. And I pray, Father God, that you have thine own way. Open our hearts and our minds to receive what you have for us, Father God. Help us to understand that, Lord, your word is the key to us living life the way you want us to. Thank you for being so kind. Thank you for being so good. For it is in the mighty, blessed, and wonderful name of Jesus that we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. If you will, turn your Bibles to the book of Matthew. Go over to chapter number 20. I'm going to take a look at verse 25. Through verse 28. 25 through verse 28. Word of God. Jesus called them unto him and said, ye know that the princes, the Gentiles, exercise dominion over them. They that are great exercise authority over unto them. But it shall not be so among you. But whosoever will be great among you, let him be your minister. Whosoever will be chief among you, let him be your servant. Amen. Even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister, and to give his life a ransom for many. If you will, for a subject, I want you to turn to your neighbor and tell them these words. Neighbor.
Neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Pastor.
Pastor.
With the help
of
the Holy Spirit.
Spirit.
We'll preach.
We'll preach.
From the subject.
From the subject.
At your service.
At your service.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Some of you are looking at me like something is wrong with me. Because many people have gotten to the idea the preacher ought to have a three-piece suit, a tie, a little pocket watch with a chain on it, and a Bible the size of this platform right here. But I know many of them that got all of them and all of the above, and God's Spirit does not dwell with them. Many a time when we do, we minimize what God maximizes. And we maximize what God has minimized. As your pastor, I could care less. When somebody comes in, God looks at the heart.
Amen.
And when we don't accept and love people for who they are and what God made. And make them feel uncomfortable because they don't have on the right outfit. Can I help you with a mess up? Because what Christ said, he said, birds have nests and foxes have holes, but the Son of Man have nowhere to lay his head. Jesus never tried to be nothing. He never tried to boast about nothing. All Jesus came to do was help us. And really, when they tried to put a robe on it, they tried to put a crown on it. I'm about to say it, but I ain't gonna say it. He came in on a donkey. Didn't want to be that. But you know what he did want to do? He did want to serve. He did want to serve. It was his mission and goal to serve. Now, here's the thing. We look at his death, his burial, and resurrection. But we never look at it as him serving. Why? Because we never ever look at the true essence that Jesus Christ didn't have to do what he did. He chose to do what he did. He chose to love us when we was no good. He chose to be there for us, even when we didn't do right. He chose to give us new mercies daily, even when time after time we acted as if we were ungrateful children. He came. He came to serve. Where's Deacon Sam? Is he in the back? Tell him to come here. There are a few people I'm going to give something to. When I give it to you, all I want you to do is hold it up. Just want you to hold it up. Just want you to hold it up. That's all I want you to do. Allow people to see what you have. Where's Brother Lack? Sit. Where you at? My compadre. Just hold it up. Then Brother Lee had to go. He's still back there. Tell him to come here. Just hold it up. Call Brother Lee. Just hold it up. A little unorthodox today. The Lord woke me up at 3 o'clock this morning. Have you tell you to do something, you make sure you do it. No matter how crazy it look. No matter if folks look at you like y'all looking at you right now. You better do it. Because you ain't got to answer to the person next to you. You got to answer to God. My sister Delilah. Just hold it up. Whatever you decide. As Christians, we look at service from a small way of thinking. But if we looked at service the way God wants us to look at service, you'll realize you can serve people in little ways. And sometimes serving people could be just treating them like they're a people. You can serve by showing kindness. How many people you know walk around, got stuff on their mind, been talked about because of where they're from, who their mom and daddy is, their past, all the things they may have done, even done wrong. But all they need from you is a word of kindness. To let them know, yeah, I know you feel you're worthless, but just remember, there's a God that sent his son Amen. To die for you because you're worth something.
Oh, yes. Amen. Amen. Amen.
We look at service from a small frame of mind. Mama used to tell me, son, if somebody do anything for you, the least you can say is thank you. Thank you. You can serve people just by showing them you appreciate what they do. That's all. Just appreciate what they do. And when you serve that way, can I help you? You can make more of an impact on people sometimes than actually giving them something monetary. How many people you know seem as if they're hopeless? They don't know which way to turn, which way to go. They're trying to figure life out. Backs up against the wall. They've tried this, tried that, tried the other. But it seems as like they have no hope. But one thing the Lord showed me is that the least you can do for a person as let them know that as long as they're alive, there is still hope. I don't care how dark it looks. I don't care how bad it looks. I don't care what you've been through. I don't care how hard you think it is. There is still hope. There's still hope. One thing God showed me a long time ago is that many times as Christians, we miss the boat because we spend so much time trying to accumulate and acquire possessions and even knowledge. But one thing he let me know is that he put us here. He put us here to love other people. You know why? Because he loved us even while we were still sinners. See, as Christians, the way we serve, it should be through love. Well, preacher, where do you get that from? Without love, can I help you? Any deed you do, without love, it's just like you have done nothing in the eyes of God. Because can I help you? God is concerned about your motives. I don't want you just doing stuff because it feels like the right thing to do. Do it out of love. Because you have a heart and a sincere heart for the individual that you are appreciating or that you want to seek the best interest of. How many of you know that in the world we live in today, people don't even honor one another? I'm not going to go down to Pastor Street. I'm going to leave that where it is. Because pastor today ain't like pastor was back then. Back then, people honored the pastor. Now, people dog the pastor. But because an individual is a human being, can I help you? They deserve your honor. Brothers and I, we went to Brother Lee's brother's funeral on yesterday. It was a celebration. It wasn't a sad occasion. We had a good time in the Lord. And Brother June made a statement. He said, parents used to tell me, June, even a dog deserves a high.
Amen.
Now, hello? We won't even give the respect to one another that we ought to at least give to a dog. We can serve by doing some things that we feel as though it's not really serving. See, when you serve, can I help you? All you're doing is looking out for the best interest of somebody else. That's service. If you are doing something for the benefit of someone else, for their personal benefit, you are serving them. You don't have to come up with this big old grand plan to try to do this, that, and the other. Can I help you? Sometimes it's just saying, you know what? I appreciate you. You know what? I admire you. You know what? I love you. You know what? I love the way you do this, that, or the other. And then working in the school system around children, many times what they do all day long is spend time dishonoring one another, talking about one another, downing one another. But the Lord revealed that to me. They can only do what they see mama and daddy do. They can only do what they see us do. If we can't treat one another right, what do we expect the children to do? See the conversation some of y'all had that you think them children ain't listening to? They listening. You've got to understand that you can serve other people. And nothing has to exchange hands. But can I help you? What comes from the heart does reach the heart. Oh, yes. It does reach the heart. So we've got to understand that God has called us. He's called us to serve. Now, those that are holding up the envelope, there's a little something in there. One of them has some value in it as far as, you know, monetary. But I ain't saying who it is. Amen. So, yeah, don't tag up too much in church. Amen. Try to tag up. You can put them down. Amen. Amen. But you can look inside, and there is something in there just to remind you of how Pastor wants to serve you, or how you serve Pastor, or Pastor just letting you know that you are blessed. Amen. You may be seated. Let's move into the scriptures. I won't keep you long, because I've kept you too long already. It's every pastor's desire for every member to get it. To get it. To just get it. And I mean just get what he wants of them. To get it. To get it. Verse 25. Says, but Jesus called them to himself and said, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord over them, and those who are great exercise authority over them. But it says, yet it shall not be so among you. See, Jesus was talking to his disciples, and he was letting them know that, yeah, I know you see the heathens do what they do. But at the same time, the way they look at greatness and the way they look at, you know, being first in line, I don't want y'all to look at greatness that way. Because he says, yet it shall not be so among you. And what he was trying to get them to understand is that don't get caught up by what you're seeing and what the world has perceived as greatness. I need you to look at it from another perspective. One thing I want you to leave with is that we must evaluate our perception of what we feel greatness is. And parents, we have a great task, because many times what we do is, sometimes we send the wrong message to our children as to what greatness is. And really, truthfully, we get in trouble because, oh, you gotta be this, you gotta be that, you gotta be the other, you gotta go here, you gotta go there, you gotta do this, you gotta do that, you gotta do the other. And I even know children, even as adults, still trying to please their parents. But you gotta understand that parents, we've got to be careful. We've got to make sure they understand the true essence of what greatness really is. Because we can leave the impression that greatness is having degrees behind your name, having a big house, having a big car, and having this great education in a field that you hate. But that's not greatness. What came to mind with this scripture right here? Many of you watch the draft, and you watch sports, and you watch players, and you watch people get drafted either to the NBA, the baseball league, or to the football league, and they're number one. They're dynamic. They're the top of the class. I mean, they got the skills. They know what to do. But one thing you gotta understand is that even with that, I don't care how able you are and how much ability you have, I need you to understand that greatness has less to do with ability and more to do with humility. Because I can get drafted, number one draft pick, but if I can't work with the team, I would be very successful. I will suffer, and the team will suffer, and we'll all lose together. It has less to do with ability and more with humility. There's several players that I know that have gone to the league and they were top of the line, but when they got to the league, didn't know how to, work with others, couldn't do this, wouldn't go to practice, wouldn't acknowledge their, teammates and stuff like that. Didn't make it. You know why? They didn't understand that you can be as good as you want, but you have to humble yourself to understand that, guess what? It ain't about you. One thing we gotta always remember, it's not about us. So you can't get caught up in the limelight and trying to be this and trying to be the other and trying to be that, because you gotta understand that it has less to do with ability and more to do with humility. It says, but whoever desires to be great among you, let him be your servant. Let him be your servant. Wait a minute. Jesus is telling them, if you want to be great, serve. Wait a minute. Parents, that's not a job we tell our children to go out and get. To serve. No, we tell them, you be this and you do this and you be better than this and you be better than that. But Christ is saying, if you want to be great, serve. What Christ will allow you to do, he will allow you to serve through your abilities, long as you realize the abilities that you have, you didn't give them to yourself. He gave them. See, greatness is found in serving others. It's found in serving others. See, It's hard to be called a servant when the only one that you focus on or the only one that has your attention is you. Selfishness is a miserable existence. It's kind of like a first responder that goes on the scene of a crash, goes on the scene of a fire, goes on the scene of a crime, and they look at their watch, and it's time for them to clock out. So they say, oh, well, my shift is over. I'm gone. First responder, I don't care if you're supposed to get on 20 minutes ago. You got to finish the job. You know why? Because it ain't about you. It's about you helping in this situation because of what you have been called to do. That's why, people of God, you got to understand that just like a firefighter, you've got to be able to go in the fire, deal with the fire. Because guess what? Fire and pain comes along with it. So you can't get all upset because guess what? That comes along with servanthood. All that comes along with it. See, nobody now wants to roll up their sleeves. Everybody want a point. Oh, that's why he rolled his sleeves up. Somebody said it in their mind when I came out with you. Roll the sleeves up too. Nobody want to roll their sleeves up. But everybody got something to say about everything. I'm going to read something that I got from something that was posted in one of the teachers' rooms. And when I read it, some of you may have read it before or saw it before, but I'll go ahead and read it. It's called Everybody, Somebody, Anybody, and Nobody. This is a short story about four people named Everybody, Somebody, Anybody, and Nobody. That was an important job to be done, and everybody was sure that somebody would do it. Anybody could have done it, but nobody did. Somebody got angry about that because it was everybody's job. Everybody thought anybody could do it, but nobody realized that everybody wouldn't do it. It ended up that everybody blamed somebody, but nobody did what anybody could have done. I don't roll up this season. And it's amazing how what would happen is before we would serve other people, I've seen it myself, we would sit back and talk about everything that they've done wrong before we would step in and help. And it's amazing that really truthfully we're living in a world where nobody really wants to serve each other anymore. Next segment of the scripture. And whoever desires to be first among you, let him be your slave. Now, I'm going to go back. This one says servant. This one says slave. This word comes from the word we get deacon from, diakonos, which means one who's able to follow orders. Ain't nobody want to do that no more. Nobody want to be under nobody's authority no more. Nobody want to do what they want to do. Diakonos. Okay? The next one is slave, which comes from the word Greek word doulos. Right? Okay? Which comes from the Greek word doulos. And that word doulos is a little deeper. And it talks about a bond servant, an actual slave. So what Christ did, he went from minister to slave. All right? So you got to understand that he's letting us know that guess what? There's no extent to the level at which you should serve. You should be willing to go all the way. You should be willing to go all the way. But what happens a lot of times is, many times as we serve, we'll do something, we'll give something, we'll say, that's good, that's enough. But when we're doing that unto God, can I help you? It's going to cause us to take it to a whole other level. It will. But see, that's a personal thing between us and God. I can't, you know, judge how your level of service is, and you can't really judge mine, because really only God knows. But can I help you? When you truly see God, he's going to show you yourself. Okay? The highest honor comes through a life of sacrifice. Notice what's said, a lifestyle of sacrifice. Not just doing some things for some people in some situations, but being able to go all the way, all the time for anyone. That's to even people who have done me wrong, yes. Yes. Even people who call you out of your name, yes. Even people who have done things to intentionally harm you, yes. Yes. God has called us to serve others. He didn't put restraints on who that was. So we've got to get to a point where we live a life of service and we understand that God has called us to be there, one for another. It reminds me of the soldier, where, I remember the story of King David, huh? He had all the wives in the house. So they pretty black woman on their ledge. And he said, I want that. And he got a whole bunch of them at the house. He said, I want that. And he took a man's wife who had one wife, and he had a whole bunch at the house. David called that man from war to go be with his wife so he wouldn't get tagged for being the father. And you know what that man done? He stayed at the palace. He stayed at the palace. He said, how I'm going to go and join my wife and my counterparts are out at war? That's a lifestyle of sacrifice. Nobody ever preached about you, right? But can I help you? You want to know what true servanthood is? That's service. That's service. Because he understood that, guess what? What he had to do, his calling to war, was greater than him what? Enjoying himself. And he couldn't find himself to enjoy himself and allow those who are at battle with him to be fighting, and he's there enjoying himself. Servanthood is living a life of sacrifice. See, sacrifice calls for us to go beyond what's convenient. See, as Christians, sometimes we want a convenient religion. A Burger King religion. I want to have it my way, when I want, how I want. But in God's eyes, very truthfully, can I help you? What he's called you to do, he's called you to do. We can't get to the point where, you know, we ignore what he's called us to do. And can I help you? Really, what he's called you to do, he really expects that to take care of you. But you know what we do sometimes? We spend our life trying to find other stuff to do besides what God called us to do. And all he wants you to do is serve in the capacity that he's called you to. But the highest honor comes to a lifestyle of serving. Well, last thing of scripture. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for men. He didn't come to be served, he came to serve. It amazes me how we talk about ministry and ministers. But when we talk about ministry and ministers, many people don't realize the root word of ministry is minister. And minister means to serve. And as a minister, no matter what ministry you're in, if the sole purpose is, you know, you, me, myself, and I, your agenda, what you think, and it don't involve nobody else, it's not ministry. Amen. That's your agenda.
All right.
That's your agenda. But the Son of Man came not to be served. He even washed his disciples' feet. Washed his disciples' feet. Did he have to do that? No. But you know what he wanted to show them? They get what? Don't try to seek to be all this, that, and the other. Understand that if you live a life of serving others, then guess what? You will be great. Because can I help you? In the eyes of God, down is up. Down is up. But can I help you? Down, but not pulling other folk down. Why are you down? But down is up. And can I help you? The Lord has shown me so vividly. When you humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, he will elevate you. You don't fret. Some folk worry when adversity comes and things happen and people see things and things are done. And I help you. God sees all and he knows all. God ain't sleeping in, he ain't gonna sleep no time soon. And can I help you? He's a righteous judge. And we've got to live a life of servanthood in the eyes of God, because guess what? When we stand before God, you know what he's going to judge us according to? The works and the deeds we've done in our body. How did you treat your neighbor? How did you treat your fellow man? How did you serve with the gifts and abilities that I'm given? And we all have to answer for the deeds we've done in this body.
Amen.
We've got to understand that God wants us to understand this. That Christ came, all Christ came to do was be a blessing to other people. Who's it? Some folk ain't got time for nobody else. If you on their time and they feel like you taking too much time, they out the door. But all Christ came to do is be a blessing. That's it. This is what I want you to understand. That the ministries that we have, that we've got to understand, that we've got to look at those with the talents. Okay? That was one given five talents. A guy given five talents, one given two talents, and one given a talent. These talents were put in their hand, and the master went away. The one with the five actually invested, did what he had to do, and he doubled. The one with the two took what he had, invested it, planted it, and he doubled. The one with the one, you know what he did? He buried it. You know what the Lord called him? You wicked, lazy, evil, I'm gonna stop. Evil servant. We can't be servants that have something in our hand and we won't allow it to grow. God wants dividends from our service. God doesn't want us to be serving in the church, serving in our ministries, and we bear no fruit. Some don't pray about their ministry. They don't work with that ministry. They don't never try to grow that ministry. It's never nothing. And really, truthfully, that says that God, I'm taking the one talent and I'm there. So when you come back, I'm going to give the one you gave me right back. If that ain't evil, I don't know what is. People of God, take what God has given you and you grow it. You work it. You nourish it. You cherish it. And understand that God didn't put it in your hand just to say you got it. Amen. He put it in your hand so that he can see some fruit from the work you've done. If you're still doing the same thing you've been doing for the last 20 years, how evil and wicked are you? No intentions to do better. No intentions to grow. No intentions to thrive towards greatness. We still coming in late. We still doing the same thing. We still talking about one another. We still tearing one another down. We still gossiping. We still lying. And God says that the harvest is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Somebody needs to do some work.
Amen.
Christ can come at any time.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
It's time out for this minuscule, minute, immature, crazy, childish stuff. God wants to see some benefits and some dividends from what it is that he's put in our hand.
Mm-hmm.
And let me tell you, as long as he let me live, yeah, I'm going to push you. Yeah, I'm going to try to get the best out of you. Yeah, I'm going to talk to you. Yeah, I'm going to give you a call. Because I want to see us do great. Because average ain't good enough.
Amen.
Amen.
It ain't good enough. Because why? We've got to be servants. And we've got to serve. Can I help you? The world seems as if they got it down pat.
And we still tripping with ourselves. Still don't even know how to treat one another. What kind of stuff is that? And what we'll do is not so selfish, we don't even realize that we're hindering the advancement of the kingdom. That's selfish. But God sent me here to let us know we will be judged. And when we all, can I help you? There will be no excuses. There will be no excuses. But see, when everybody else go home and do what they gotta do, they on their time clock and this, that, and the other, pastor prays and pastor this, he shouldn't have said this, he shouldn't have said that. God is telling me where my food at. Now you can do whatever you want. Say whatever you want. But God said, where my fruit? Where my fruit? You're supposed to be helping folk to grow. You're supposed to be helping folk to get where they need to be. They're supposed to be growing in that calling. Where my fruit? You know what I've discovered? There's some parasites among us. But can I help y'all? When you in the will of God, what he'll do is, he'll allow you to overcome some stuff, even though it is there. And you've got to do the work you need to do, regardless. And can I help you? God got the best pesticide there is. And when he come through and he do what he does, can I help you? He's going to do better than you can do. So you don't work, you keep working, you keep striving, you keep doing what God has called you to do, and you don't worry about all that. Because you know why? You got to think about Christ Jesus. Every time you go to do ministry, think about Christ. Every time you about to give up, you think about Christ. Every time you lied on, think about Christ. Every time you talked about, think about Christ. Every time folk come against you and persecute you, think about Christ. Because can I help you? They spit on him. They gave him a crown of thorns. They played the lottery with his clothes. But can I help you? He still said, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
Amen.
Whenever you get in that spot, remember what Christ has done for you. It's going to help you to serve.
Amen.
And what'll happen is, folks ain't gonna know why you're doing what you're doing. They gonna be like, well, I'll be done wrong. But you can't worry about that. You know why? Because Christ did it all for you. And you know you gotta understand that guess what? If it got hard enough for Christ to say, yeah, Lord, please remove this cup, it might get a little hard for you sometime.
Amen.
But he said these words, he said, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. And can I help you? He moved on from the garden. And he got up. And when Judas came with his no good, no down scoundrel self, Peter cut his ear off. And Jesus said, stop, man. He got to do that. God, guess his purpose is to deceive me and be low down. Let him be low down. And he cut his ear, and Jesus, okay, there you go. And he healed that soldier's ear. And what you got to understand is that Judas kissed him in deceit. But guess what? Jesus had something on his mind. Jesus had a purpose on his mind. You know what his purpose was? Serving others. You know what his purpose was? You. You know what his purpose was? You. You know what his purpose was? You. And he had you on his mind as he was rolling his way to the cross. Could you imagine dying for folk that could care nothing about you? Could you imagine serving folk that don't even care you even exist? But Jesus said, you know what? I'm dying for the no good and those who think they fairly good. And he kept on going to that cross. And they tell me that Jesus Christ stretched out wide. And guess what? He could have come down. He could have had legions. He could have had angels and everything come down. But you know what? He stayed there. And guess what? It wasn't the nails. It was his love. His love kept him on that cross.
Amen.
And they tell me, yeah, when he gave up the ghost, yeah, they took him down. They spit him in his side to make sure the deal was done. But yeah, they had to put him in the tomb. But that wasn't the end. When they buried it, 3 days later, he got up. With all power in his hand, I'm here to encourage somebody. Keep on serving, keep on living, keep on doing what God called you to do. Because one of these old days, he's going to resurrect some stuff in your life. Don't you work, and you got to get it. Then guess what? Serving Christ, guess what? It ain't popular. When you really do it the way he wants you to do it. It ain't popular at all. Because really, you know what it might make you do? It might make you lose some friends you once had before.
Amen.
But don't be deceived. Trust in Jesus. And know that he did it. He did it. When you look at people, this is what Pastor wants you to do. When you look at people, stop looking at their clothes.
Alright.
Stop looking at their past. Stop looking at what they're going through right now. Stop looking at their addictions. Because can I help? That's just a consequence of being in this flesh. The least you can do is tell them how you doing. God loves you. People of God, spend a life of serving other people. Spend a life of showing others that God actually does live in you. Because any Christian who can't show love, that's just as mean as they want to be, and treat people any kind of way, can I help you? I question whether God lives in them or not.
All right.
Yes. Yes. Amen. Question that. And we've got to serve.
Yes.
Got to serve. Even when it's inconvenient, even when it's not popular, and even when folk don't pat you on the back. That's our problem. We want acceptance. Yeah. We want everybody to like us. Can I help you? Some folk ain't gonna like you. And some folk ain't gonna like you just because they don't like you. And some folk ain't gonna like you just because they don't like the fact that you're doing what you're doing. And some folk ain't gonna like you because they want what you got and can't have what you got. So you keep serving. Why? Because God has called you to it, not you.
Amen.
And it ain't about us, y'all. It's about you.
Amen.
Serve each other. Love each other. Love on people. Every Christian in here should be able to be identified for their love. For their love. For their love. That love. And you can get mad. Everybody get mad. But can I help you? Love gonna show up sooner or later. I told y'all before, my daddy, he'll cuss you out and then give you the shirt off your back. The type of person he was, but he had love in his heart. They got some folks will cuss you out, then step on you and spit on you. Chew you up, spit you out. Then talk about you. You serve. You serve. You keep serving, and you keep serving, and you keep serving. But nobody said it was going to be easy.
Amen.
Nobody said it was going to be easy. When you see people, when you see others, guess what? Lend them a helping hand. And one thing God showed, the very people
that you never thought you'd ever have to serve and come back and help, that's the very same ones that you may have to lend a hand to. But that's in God's time.
Amen.
May God keep you and may God bless you. Here's my prayer. Amen.